I have just finished reading the stories that were written by Gary D. Schmidt, and all I can say to you guys is, wow. And he has a whole new one for us that is Okay For Now. That's coming up next on Books Alive. Hello, and thank you so much for joining us today on Books Alive. This is a time I'm going to tell you it was very, this is a challenging author for me. I read this man's books in the space and reread them in the space of about 2.5 days. I can't tell you how incredible it was. I just walked away with a wow. So I'm really excited to tell you that sitting in the studio with me is the one and only Gary Schmidt. Welcome.
Thank you very much.
He is a 2-time Newbery Honor winner, a 1-time Prince Honor winner, and is it fair to say you're writing for about 10 to 14-year-olds?
Yeah, middle grade books,
middle grade
fiction,
okay.
Right.
All right. He's in town these days because he has just published a new book called Okay For Now that's a companion for that fantastic book, Wednesday Wars, that everybody loved. So this is where the excitement is right now. This is where the buzz is. But I want you to understand who he is a little bit, how he has written, what he's been writing to get to this place. So we're going to back up just a little bit before Okay For Now and have a little bit of a conversation.
Good.
All right. So you grew up on Long Island?
On Long Island, in a little town. Wasn't so little, really, called Hicksville.
Uh-huh.
I don't tell a whole lot of people that, because as soon as you say Hicksville,
uh-oh,
you have certain stereotypes that come in. But it was a suburb from Manhattan and Flushing and such.
Uh-huh.
And yeah, it was a regular suburban town.
Did you move to New England because so many of your books are set there?
All of my people are from New England. My grandparents came from New England on my mother's side, I should say.
Mm-hmm.
And so we went up there quite a bit. We were in Cape Cod almost every summer. Went to college in New England. But never actually lived there myself. We always lived on Long Island.
But clearly it draws you.
Absolutely. We go back, I go back most Januaries with a group of students, and then we go back to Maine, which is my wife's family side, every summer for several weeks as well.
Okay. So you, as a child, were you thinking, author baby, that's it?
There are a lot of writers who are like that,
uh-huh,
who have a pencil in their hand when they come out of the womb, you know, and they write poetry and journals,
yes,
you know, all the juvenilia,
uh-huh,
and they say, you know, write these long,
yeah.
That wasn't me.
No.
I was one of the kids in the class that was a very poor reader, very, very poor reader, and in that school system, we were tracked as early as first grade, so that you knew that if you were track one, you were going to college and you'd have a great job, blah, blah, blah.
Mm-hmm.
If you were track three, then you would be the guy picking up garbage and doing the janitorial services.
And
I was track three.
Wow.
And it was, we were the group that got the readers at the end. So the track one kids got the blue reader.
Uh-huh.
And then they would give those to the next kids. Finally they would come to us.
Yeah.
And since they didn't want to stigmatize us,
uh-huh,
it wasn't track one, track two. We were named by groups.
Right.
I was the pumpkin group.
You were a pumpkin.
I was a pumpkin. And there was,
wow,
I was a guy who just couldn't read.
Yeah.
And then there was a teacher early on named Miss Kavikoff, never forget her.
Mm-hmm.
And she disliked me.
Mm-hmm.
And without any testing or anything, she just took me. And I left the class and I went into her class, and it was a track one class.
Mm-hmm.
And I was, of course, way behind, and she taught me how to read.
How did she teach you how to read?
Lots of books.
She had you reading?
Lots of books, some that were easier,
mm-hmm,
and some that were a little beyond my abilities.
Mm-hmm.
Just lots. I remember mm-hmm, my desk being stuffed, filled with books,
wow,
all the time.
Wow.
And she gave me a lot of attention. And of course, as a young,
yes,
kid, you're going to thrive if you have a terrific teacher,
yes,
who believes in you and is,
right,
going to give you attention.
Right.
And I started to read a lot more.
Wow.
And I remember her handing me Bambi, which is not an easy book.
No.
And much more difficult conceptually than the Disney film.
Yeah.
And just thriving
wow.
with that. And that really wow. changed things for me.
You know, that's really interesting because I would have guessed, number one, that you came from a family of readers.
My grandmother, but not so much my immediate family.
Okay.
Yeah.
All right. And Mim Fox has taught me that when you can make reading be about connection and closeness, that gives children a reason to read.
Mm-hmm.
She says children learn language because they want to be able to talk and connect to their caregiver, their love person.
Absolutely.
And reading can do the same thing. Wow. Okay. Well, let's speed up the film just a little bit.
This
and
could
you
take
ended
a long
up
time.
At Calvin College.
Well, I went to undergraduate at Gordon College
okay.
in New England, and then I'm teaching now at Calvin College.
At Calvin
right.
College.
Yeah.
And what drew you to that particular school?
I went to graduate school at University of Illinois, which is a terrific school, very high-powered, very competitive, and not always, I think, in a healthy competitive way in terms of academics.
Mm-hmm.
I walked in for a job interview at Calvin College,
mm-hmm.
and the faculty, this is going to sound sentimental and sweet, and I don't
Never.
Mean it that way, but
Never.
It was really interesting. The faculty of the English department were gathered around
mm-hmm.
A guy who was in his 60s or so, and one of them had written a poem that another had set to music, and they were singing this birthday
wow.
poem. And it was an emblem for me of a kind of closeness that I hadn't seen
right.
before.
Right.
Maybe at Gordon. I think it for sure at Gordon.
Yes.
But certainly not at a Big Ten school.
Ah.
Where there was a unity of fellowship, I
yeah.
think is one word, but
yeah.
also a unity of mission.
Oh.
And one of the things that was striking is how united they were
mm-hmm.
in their mission. It was also a place where there were many people writing, all different sorts of things, from creative work to academic work. And there was a mutual celebration of that work. People would tell me about what other people were writing that wouldn't be in other research institutions. Where there was a sense that together as a
mm-hmm.
department we're putting this stuff out. And that's still true of Calvin College.
So what's the mission that you have joined?
A mission that's very, very committed to great teaching. A mission that's teaching in a faith tradition
mm-hmm.
where we see our students as whole people, spiritual, academic, social, aesthetic.
Mm-hmm.
All those elements come together
mm-hmm.
and we hit those very, very hard. And a mission where there's a sense of the arts as well, where those things are important, particularly in our tradition, music.
Mm-hmm. Wow. It sounds to me like it's very authentic. Like you guys
that's
are
a
really
good word for it.
Coming from, you know, where you really exist, who you really are,
mm-hmm.
what you want to put in the world. I have a son who's in a PhD program, and he's learning to measure meaning. And he works for a university, and they're trying to figure out what means something in your life as you go down the road, as opposed to when you're 18, and how can a university prepare you to get that meaning down the road?
Mm-hmm.
And it sounds like you guys are doing exactly that.
I think it's an interesting stat to say that out of Calvin College, 55% of our graduates, 55% go to nonprofits.
Wow.
That's everything from ministries to teaching
uh-huh.
to nonprofits in the arts to nonprofits in social situations. To world situation, it's really quite
yeah.
an amazing place.
Wow, that's really
yeah.
great. What an incubator.
I think
oh
so.
Oh my gosh, okay. So that gives you a sense of who he is, kind of where he's living right now. Oh, and he has 6 children. and now we're gonna take a look at some of the books. And I'm gonna reach over here and grab Anson's Way, which is a great place to start because it's a boy. And can you give us just a quick summary of the plot line here?
It's a young boy who's a fencible. He's coming into, which is kind of soldier. It's 1730. He's a British soldier. He's coming over to Ireland. He is completely convinced of the rightness of his position, which is the British Empire, on and on. England at this time has 2 Catholic neighbors, and they're terrified. There's Ireland on one side. There's France on the other. They're afraid that they'll unite, or they're afraid that the French will come over and unite and create a rebellion in Ireland. And so you have the beginning of what are today known as the Troubles. And the Britons decide, since you can't dominate France, they can dominate Ireland.
Ah.
And it becomes illegal, essentially, to have anything that's affirmed in Irish culture, language, religion, anything. And so this kid comes over believing in the rightness of that cause and understands over the course of time that maybe he's not quite as he thinks it is.
Yes.
So that's the story of that.
Yes. Now, his father is the colonel.
He's the colonel, and he wants to please his father.
Yes, and I got the feeling he wanted to be not only like his father, but his grandfather, his great-grandfather. You know, they had all become fencibles, which is a unit out of Staffordshire, if I remember right.
And it's a long family tradition, and it's an honorable tradition that goes way, way back.
And he's the drummer, so he's there for everything, beating the drums.
And starting off, therefore, it's a very young boy in this long tradition.
What is he, 12?
Something like 13 or 14, yeah.
Okay. Now, he's going to meet some interesting things. He's looking for glory.
Mm-hmm.
He's looking for honor. He wants to maintain tradition. And he's seeing some of the realities of his father's position. There's a not-so-wonderful person named Lord Melville.
Mm-hmm. Very wealthy.
Yes. Who tests his father.
He's the powerful resource. He's the one that you're protecting, in a way, because he's British, but he has a large estate in Ireland.
Mm-hmm.
Cheap to live there. Easy to live there in some ways, but his cause is not the Irish cause. The emblematic moment is when the fencibles come to take the horse of the one guy who has this horse. True story of an Irish soldier who had, in fact, fought for the British in their cavalry units, had come back with his horse, given because of his bravery, brings it back to his farm, this beautiful, beautiful horse. But it's illegal now for an Irishman to own a horse worth more than £5. Incredible irony. The British had given it to him, but it's illegal. So they come down to take the horse, and this is a true story. And when the man sees this, he can't possibly abide it, and he loves the horse. And he takes out a pistol to kill the horse. And as soon as he takes the pistol out, he is regarded as a hostile, and he's killed. When this kiddo sees this, he has a sense that something, obviously, is really awry in this world, to have those ironies played out.
Yes.
With no cost to the British, and here's a dead man for nothing.
Right.
Because he loved this horse.
And someone who had taken a bullet for the king in the king's service. So there's all this gray.
Yeah.
Enormous gray.
Life is much more complicated than he can possibly imagine. Right.
All right. Now, this is a great moment for you to explain why you write for this age group, this 10 to 14, 15-year-olds.
That age group, junior high, in my time, middle school today, is at this pivotal moment in their development where, on the one hand, they're looking back towards the securities of childhood, which is, one hopes, for most kids, secure on some level, where the decisions are mostly parental decisions, where there is this large support system, and where a kid is looking for home. I mean, that's the big thing. And I think if you had one big theme of children's books, children's literature, it's home. I mean, it's Make Way for Ducklings. You're establishing a home,
right.
Really. And then middle grade fiction, I think, is about a child starting to look towards adulthood, where you are now thinking about not necessarily finding home security, but also going out into the world. And we all remember those weird junior high years when we're between those two things. We're looking back and forward, securities of home, childhood, looking forward towards adulthood, the social things that are going on, the physical things, spiritual things, everything that's going on in your head, where you are moving to face adulthood. You don't become an adult in middle school, but you start to move towards facing it. And we all know people who never make that look, certainly. But let's say that in a normal social development,
someone is. I never thought of it that way.
Well, you are. I mean, just watch the commercials of guys watching football games, and you see people who have never made that look.
Thank you. Okay.
But that's what's going on there, and I find that fascinating. You know,
yeah,
what is it that happens? What's the constellation of things in our life?
Yeah.
And it's not just one thing.
Right.
That helps us to look away from the securities of childhood towards the insecurities and unsettlement of looking towards adulthood, where you become responsible.
Right.
What a fascinating thing to look for, because in our culture, there isn't the one thing. I mean, there isn't a ceremony in general, some.
Right.
But not in general, that we all accept, that we all adhere to. Maybe a driver's license is the closest that you have.
Okay.
Where everyone at this point says, yeah, this ceremony means I'm now an adult. We don't all have that in common. So what is it that drives us in that way, that encourages us to look that way, when everything says, no, stay safe?
Right, right.
Why do we do that?
Yes.
That's what I'm fascinated by.
And if you look at your parents, as many of your characters do, and you say, nuh-uh, nope, that's not working for me.
Not what I want to be.
Yeah.
Sure.
Yeah.
You have to find your own thing.
Mm-hmm. All right, so we'll get to those characters. Okay, I want to touch on this because you don't just stick with one thing here. This is Saint Seran, I think you told me.
Seran,
okay. The tale of a saint of Ireland. Now, why did you pick this saint of all the saints?
What a fascinating guy. You know, everyone thinks saints in Ireland, you think Patrick, obviously,
sure.
is the first one. He's before Patrick.
Mm-hmm.
He's a kiddo. Though on the cover, he's an adult in that one. But in fact, when he first comes, he's a pretty young guy.
Mm-hmm.
Now, what would... This is an amazing story. You come to Ireland as a young boy, and you're going to be this sort of missionary kind of feel. And when he gets there, no one wants him. And he's even threatened. And he's like, no, we're not interested in you. So, why would you stay? First of all, how do you get the guts to do that? By yourself. And then why stay when it's clear that you're not wanted?
Mm-hmm.
And he goes up north and founds a monastery. And his the people who come are all animals. And yet, so why stay?
Yeah.
But he has this amazing sense of purpose that's really, to me, quite ennobling.
Ah.
He's the St. Francis of Ireland, essentially. And though uh-huh. he isn't as well known as St. Francis with his love of animals,
right.
Seran had the same feel
oh.
to him. And lots of little stories about him. I just love the story.
Yeah.
But I love the noble quality of a kid who mm-hmm. would say, this is what I'm supposed to be doing. I know this is what I'm supposed to be doing.
Mm-hmm.
And you want to say, isn't this a cool thing
yeah.
for to our kids to know so strongly that this is what I'm going
Your
to be
purpose.
Doing? So I admire him.
It sounds like the excuse me, the purpose that you all have there at Calvin College, too, you know,
mm-hmm.
where you've figured it out.
You hope that you're helping kids to figure it out.
Yeah. Okay, now this is a huge shift. This is Mara's, am I saying
stories,
it right?
Mara's stories.
Mara's stories. And they are glimmers in the darkness. You went to the Holocaust for these.
When I was growing up on Long Island, most of my friends were Jewish.
Mm-hmm.
I think I was the only Protestant kid on the block, in fact. And so we participated in a lot of that life. A lot, the dinners, the bar mitzvahs. But one of the things that was coming out in the 60s, of course there were the Holocaust stories like the Anne Frank stories, the true witness stories, but there were also stories that I heard as young as 7th, 8th grade that were folktale stories that had come out of the barracks, stories that were told in the barracks of the Holocaust
mm-hmm.
From one to another. They were amazing stories.
Mm-hmm.
I mean, huge stories. There was one, the cover story is from an eighth grade, a story I heard in eighth grade about a violinist who doesn't survive. And they were heartbreaking, unbelievable stories.
Yeah.
So when I was writing, they were always in my head, and I wondered if there were more, and I began to collect more and more and more of those.
Mm-hmm.
And they seemed to me to speak very strongly of the human condition,
mm-hmm.
not just that particular, but of that particular, but also the human condition. And they became extremely powerful for me. There are issues, obviously, of a guy named Schmidt retelling Holocaust stories.
Oh, gosh, I didn't put that together.
I did. So
Whoa.
There was. I finished the book
yeah.
and thought, I'm not sure I can do this.
Yeah.
So I put it away
yeah.
for quite a long while.
Uh-huh.
And then Elie Wiesel came out with his autobiography in two volumes. And the second one, and the Sea is Never Full, talks about people who appropriate the Holocaust and use it. And I thought, that's it, I can never use this. But
right.
I really like the stories.
Right.
So I finally sent the whole manuscript to Elie Wiesel.
Wow.
And said, can I do it?
Yeah.
And he wrote back this terrific letter, which I didn't really expect.
Yeah.
And it said, stories of social justice, send it out.
Oh.
So I sent it out, and it got published as Mara's Stories.
Wow.
Yeah.
Well, I didn't get a chance to read them all, but I read about half of them. And I have to say, The Violinist and the Master is the one you were talking
yeah.
about. I was just, I mean, A Tale of Two Cities.
Mm.
You know?
Mm-hmm.
It's A Tale of Two Cities
Because
for
one
me.
Takes the other's place.
Yes. And leave, knowing he's going to leave behind something so wonderful
right.
for everyone.
Hoping. He doesn't
yes.
know. He doesn't
yes.
know if the master will survive
yeah.
or not.
Yeah.
He has to believe that some goodness in the universe will save the master
mm-hmm.
because of the sacrifice that he's making, and he does.
These are very, very short stories, but each one just leaves you with this very profound feeling, and they would make a great read aloud. Do you have a theory on the power of story?
Hmm. We are creatures. We are human beings. Do order our lives through narrative. We come together,
order
we tell stories.
Order our lives through narrative.
And we often think of our lives as stories. Biographies suggest that our life is a story.
Yes.
A life is a story. Autobiography or memoir.
History.
Orders that.
Yes.
And I think on that level, stories are powerful. Mm-hmm. We also understand narrative as human beings. We just do. We tell stories to each other.
Mm-hmm.
And we use it in ways to help us to understand the larger world. I mean, what do you do at a funeral? I mean, what a bizarre situation. You go to a funeral, mm-hmm. everyone's crying, say mm-hmm. a beloved family member. After the funeral is over, you go downstairs, say, and there's sandwiches with the crust cut off or something. And everyone starts to gather around these tables, or you go back to the uncle's house or whatever.
Uh-huh.
And suddenly, you start to tell stories, and suddenly about the person perhaps, and suddenly stories are revived. And suddenly, an hour into it, you're all laughing.
Mm.
And you start to think, mm-hmm. wait a minute, mm-hmm. you know, this is such a sad time. We've just lost, but here we are because all the family members are together and the old stories are revived.
Uh-huh.
Well, what is story doing there?
Yeah.
And it's really healing us.
Oh, yes.
And it suggests our commonality and our history.
Yeah.
All of those things show the power of story, I think.
And it captures their life, the story, the pieces of their life,
absolutely.
A story. And so it's like you never lose that.
Right. Well, and if I was to say to you, tell me a story about your grandmother.
Yeah.
You'll tell a story which will be, for you, archetypal of who she was.
Ah.
And that's, I think, a very powerful thing.
Yeah, you're right. It's incredible for understanding. All right, speaking of stories, this is so fun. What a great segue. Okay, Lizzie Bright in The Buckminster Boy. Wow. Okay, so this is the one that got the Newbery Honor and the Prince Honor. All right, give us just the basic sense of what's going on here.
Well, the backstory of this is true. There was an island off the coast of Maine, Malaga Island, and probably in the 1750s, there were a group of slaves who had probably escaped. This is before the Underground Railroad.
Mm.
And had come up about as far north as you can go,
mm-hmm.
and had come to the small town Phippsburg, where they weren't wanted. But just opposite Phippsburg,
mm-hmm.
past a tidal river, there's this small island, 40 acres, pretty small.
Mm.
And so they settle there. And over the course of the next 160 years, a settlement grows up of mostly folks who are Irish-American, not wanted,
mm-hmm.
and African-American, not wanted. Mm. Both groups despised by the people in Maine. There are some small connections, not a lot. People on the island get by mostly through shellfishing and lobstering. And then in 1912, the economy of Maine dies. Wooden-bottom boats no longer being built, and they're floundering around for another economy. And that's when Maine becomes a tourist state. It didn't just happen. It was decided we'll be a tourist state. I mean, there was a conscious decision.
Mm-hmm.
And so one of the places that thought they could take advantage of this was Phippsburg, who looks out over these cliffs, and there's this, as it still is, gorgeous landscape, I mean, seascape, unbelievably beautiful. But on this island, just a stone's throw away, is this shanty town. And the governor of Maine, true story, comes down in 1912, stands on those shores, sees this shanty town,
mm-hmm.
and says, "We'll burn them out." That's a quote. "We'll burn them out." And so the people, you know, as most of us would, fled. Some didn't flee, and were there was a group that came out and put them on a raft in their house and just set it adrift in the New Meadows, which is a tidal river, flows out to the Atlantic. And then there were eight left, and it was decided that they were crazy. And so they were arrested as lunatics and brought down to Pownal near Yarmouth.
Mm-hmm.
And there they were put into an insane asylum, which still stands. Not
wow.
as an insane asylum, which
wow.
is still there. Those eight people died in 2 weeks. No one has said, I do not say no one knows, but I say no one has said how those people died.
Wow.
Buried in a common grave.
Oh,
and
my
then
gosh.
They destroyed everything on the island.
All right, so into that setting walks Turner.
Kid who doesn't know anything about it, I thought, well, like the reader, mm-hmm. I struggled with this book. Turner, like the reader, doesn't understand what's going on, doesn't understand what's at stake, and has to make a decision. And this is sort of what I mean before about turning your face from childhood towards adulthood.
Mm-hmm.
The decision that he makes is a naive one,
mm.
but it's the right one.
Mm-hmm.
And even though it won't work,
mm-hmm.
it's still the right decision.
Mm.
And so that's his growth arc in this story.
And he's got his father, who's the minister,
mm-hmm.
and he's the minister's kid. And everybody's looking at him and, you know, oh, the great scene where they want him to jump off the cliff.
Yeah, where he doesn't jump.
And I read somewhere that you did jump.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, Turner is smarter than I am. I learned.
All right, but he makes a friend of a young African-American girl.
Lizzie.
Named Lizzie. And you gave her such incredible qualities that, to me, reading that book was like, because Lizzie had lived in that book, life was worthwhile.
There's one of the things that the people in Phippsburg did to justify it was to send photographers over to the island before it was destroyed to take pictures of the people there that were meant to be proof that they were legally idiots, whatever that means. One of those pictures has a young girl leaning on a picket fence looking out, and you can see in her face, she knows what's going on. She knows what's going on. And there is this amazing, powerful defiance that I will not be defined by you. I don't care what you do. I don't care if I'm powerless against you. I'm not going to let you define who I am. That's Lizzie.
Well,
that's, she's the inspiration for Lizzie.
You captured her. How do you create a character? Do you do it before you come to write the book or as it goes along?
Yeah, it'd be nice if it was earlier, but it really is as you go along. And it's, since I type manuscripts on scrap paper, it takes me a long time, which is exactly what I want. And so when you retype and retype and retype and retype, which is what I was doing this morning in the hotel, you find... you have the chance, at least I have the chance, it works for me, to add layers, to revise, to keep making them more complex. Characters begin often with one major characteristic, but no one exists who's got one major thing. We're all this large broth of things. And so it's, it means trying to find all those different layers and add those. And for me, that's slow. It's a slow process.
What did you want her to have?
Spunk.
Spunk. Okay.
Guts.
How about the relationship, though, the connection that she has with Turner?
Yeah.
What did you want to give that?
A forbidden relationship, African-American, white kiddo. She is so confident, so much herself. He is so, though she's in the powerless position in this culture, he is in the most powerful position and has so little awareness of who he is. And so little awareness of what he's about and what his life is all about. I wanted them to have an authentic friendship, and so the dialogue was wickedly good fun to write. But I wanted her to show him fullness, show a whole person at work. And he is just developing that.
That's the magic, Gary. When you show her fullness, that's the magic. It really is. And then when you send him out there to the whales, I'm not giving this away. You're going to have to read this. But that was really amazing. That was really incredible. Okay. Wednesday Wars was next or First Boy was next?
First Boy was next.
Okay, let's grab that. All right. Now this one, to me, you wrote on a whole different level.
This was supposed to be a comedy. Lizzie Bright is pretty serious. And I wanted to have, it's important to me to try different genres. I just don't want to write the same genre because I teach this stuff and I want to have experience in many different genres. So I wanted this to be a ha-ha, funny comic book. But at the end of the first chapter, this kid whose parents have died in a fiery car accident, his grandmother died last year, the grandfather dies at the end of the first one, and the barn burns down. And that's not funny.
No.
So it's, it became something different, and it became a mystery, essentially, which I'd never done or before or since. And it was great fun for me that way, but it's not a funny book. It's more of a mystery thriller kind of book.
Right. Well, you brought in the sort of the superhero element with the big men, you know? I mean, on both sides, I could see
Turns
him.
Out to be a good guy. Mr. Bolster. At the front, he seems menacing and bad, but at the end, he's a good guy.
Yeah, and this guy has to decide a few things. I mean, he's in search of his identity, but he also is going to kind of choose between celebrity and substance as well.
And that's the big issue there.
Yeah.
He has the chance to probably be the most famous kid in America. Is he the president's son? If he is, he'll be known throughout the world, and he will be this huge thing. Or do you stay on the farm you love and work at the dairy business and probably not get known outside your town? But have a good and terrific life as a farmer, and he has to make that call. In our culture, everything around us would say, well, this is an easy call. Take the money. You know, be on Time Magazine. He doesn't want
that. But how long does that last? Okay, speaking of how long does that last, this one is called Trouble. And, I mean, I felt like you were the master of surprise in this book. Huh. I really did.
This was, it's an interest. I taught in a school system for a little while where there were kids who were amazingly wealthy. I mean, amazingly, mm-hmm. amazingly wealthy, who mm-hmm. would drive Porsches into high school, mm-hmm. their own Porsches. Mm-hmm. I taught on their tennis team. They all had these high-powered, amazing rackets. I had a Bancroft Woody. It was incredible, just the difference.
Wow.
I drove a Datsun.
Yeah.
Okay, you know what a Datsun looks like next to a row of Porsches?
Oh, yeah. Nice, yeah.
But what these kids truly believed, they really earnestly believed this, was that trouble would never touch them
wow.
because they were so wealthy.
Yeah.
They could never imagine,
mm-hmm.
really ever imagine,
mm-hmm.
that there was anything that could give them a hard time, that their lives would be fine.
Right.
And that they would never have to think. I mean, it doesn't even come into their head that mm-hmm. they would ever have to think about money.
Mm.
It's just there.
Yeah.
Some of these kids are modeled on kids from an academy in a place I go often.
Mm-hmm.
And it's these are the kids who become congressmen and senators. And when people say to me, you know, what's going on with the spending?
Yeah.
That doesn't surprise me in Congress. I mean, these,
right.
they never have had to think about money.
Okay.
Many.
Yeah.
So that's the notion of this, is what happens to a really, really rich kid
mm-hmm.
who never even thinks he needs a support system because it's just, that's the world, that's the air he breathes. What happens if real trouble comes into his life?
Mm-hmm.
You know, how does he handle that?
Yeah.
And then he's put against a kid who's from Cambodia, 1976, who's come over, immigrant kid,
mm-hmm.
whose every day is trouble.
Mm-hmm.
His whole life has been trouble. What happens when you smash them together?
Yeah. And the roots of both kids, the one who is Mr. New England with the house of rock and never gonna be threatened, and the kid who is has crawled through a field to with his own body to blow up landmines for
right.
other people, and his own father is not his father because he's a child of rape. I mean, he comes from a whole different place, and both of them trying to figure out who they are.
Absolutely.
You know? That was, this was just a killer. You need your tissue box for that one.
Huh.
Okay, let's jump to Wednesday Wars because I want to be sure we have time for, lots of time for Okay for Now. Wednesday Wars, I think, is probably the book most kids know you through of about.
This was after First Boy, and it was, all right, can I do the comedy finally?
Yeah.
And it's not, you know, I'm a Calvinist. Humor doesn't come to us all that fast. So it really is work for me to get a funny, funny book. But
uh-huh.
I also wanted it to be comedy in the Shakespearean sense,
yeah.
where you've got not ha-ha,
right.
but comedy of two communities that are at odds. And at the end, those communities are brought together,
mm.
and there's a sense of healing and wholeness that goes forward.
Mm-hmm.
That's what I wanted in the background. So my editor, Virginia Buckley, calls
mm-hmm.
this a funny book about serious things.
Mm-hmm.
And I think that's a really good description.
Yeah, it
about
really
the book.
Is. Mm-hmm. It really is. So you've got, why did you call him Hood Hood?
There was a kiddo running with my son in cross country. His name was Sean Hood Hood.
Ah.
And I thought it was the funniest name I've ever heard.
Okay.
And so, plus if you're cheering for cross country guys, you're running from place to place around a course because it goes in and out of woods.
Uh-huh.
And so I would yell, you know, first for my son, go David.
Uh-huh.
And then I would yell, go Hood Hood.
Uh-huh.
And I would just be on the floor because it's such a fun, you know, go Hood Hood.
Yeah, right.
So I wanted the name. Holling is taken from Holling Clancy Holling. He's a writer in the 1950s
okay.
and early 60s.
I wouldn't have known that.
And it's funny already. You know,
yeah.
his first name is the same as the last name.
Uh-huh.
Plus it has the alliteration.
Yeah.
At first, this guy's name was, since it's Hood Hood, the
uh-huh.
obvious name that you put in is Robin. So his
oh,
first name was Robin,
no.
middle name was Robin.
Yeah.
So it was Robin Hood Hood.
Oh no.
And then that just got stupid.
Thank you. Thank
so,
you for not doing that.
So it became
that.
Holling
yeah.
Hood Hood.
Yeah. Well, he's a great guy.
He's a good kid.
Yeah.
He too is about to turn his face towards adulthood, and this is a story about going from a dominant father who really completely controls him
mm-hmm.
to making decisions on his own.
Mm-hmm.
And where he's going to look forward to the future, and he will decide. His father essentially is offering him a job and a life,
mm-hmm.
but maybe Holling wants to decide for himself
mm-hmm.
that this is the way I want to go.
Mm-hmm.
And that's how this is the story of one academic year, seventh grade, when he starts to move in that direction
yeah.
in a tumultuous time. It's 67, 68.
You wove so much into that with the Shakespeare, and I know you guys are going to think Shakespeare. He made it hilarious. He really did. And the rats.
Rats are fun.
There were rats. I mean, the Yankees. Yeah. You must be a huge Yankee fan.
I was. We were huge Yankee fans. There was one of the scenes, the Mickey Mantle scene here, is based on a day when the Yankees came to our school. Five Yankee players.
Oh my gosh.
We thought they were going to come and bat with us.
Yeah.
And throw and such. We all came in, you know, uniforms.
Yeah.
And with our mitts and our
yeah.
baseballs. And they came onto the stage, five Yankees in the pinstripes.
Ah.
It was so, I mean, into Hicksville Junior High.
Yeah.
It was like the gods had descended.
Yes.
And they stood up on, or they sat down on chairs on
uh-huh.
the stage.
Uh-huh.
And not making this up, they never spoke to us. They just looked at each other. And finally, one guy, I won't tell you who it was, looks at his watch. He goes, okay, we're good. And they walked off.
Wow.
They never did anything.
Wow.
That was the winter of 68.
Yeah.
When that happened.
Uh-huh.
And the next year, I became a Mets fan. And 1969, you know what a good year that was? The Mets won the World Series because
great.
I became a Mets fan that
Thank
year.
Thank you.
That's
Hello.
Why. Yep, that
well,
was why.
It's a beautifully woven book, and it's really, really hilarious. All I have to say is yellow tights with white feathers on the behind. Okay? I'm just going to leave you there. Now, you took a character who was always referred to as... Say the last name.
Swiatek.
Doug Swiatek's brother.
Mm-hmm.
Doug Swiatek's brother. Okay. So here we go. This is the brand new one, and this is what you call a jewel, okay? A glistening jewel, because it has so many facets, and it has so many layers to it. It's just a precious gem. I'm going to let you set us up here.
Well, this is Doug, who comes to another town. The real town is Ellenville, New York, and it's called Marysville in the book.
Mm-hmm.
Doug is a more beat-up kid than Holling. He is not physically abused, though there is some physical abuse, but just a beat-up kid in a beat-up family.
Mm-hmm.
And he comes into town, having been forced to move. He's lost everything that he knew, and he had just been kind of starting to make friends at the end of Wednesday Wars. And now it's all taken away, and
mm-hmm.
so he's a new kid in on the block. No one knows him, and he has all his amazing defenses up, and they're powerful defenses.
They are.
And he goes into a library, and he can't read, so he goes to an upper level, and there he sees an Audubon, Birds of America.
Mm-hmm.
I made it a first edition, so it's a huge double folio book, huge book. And it's 1828. There's only 118 of these in the world.
Wow.
One just sold last month.
Wow.
But in any case, he sees this and he is stunned by the beauty of it. And this kid, who has never been seen, he doesn't do art,
mm-hmm.
is just overwhelmed by this beautiful, beautiful thing.
Mm.
But Audubon, the reason there's only 118 is that Audubons are more valuable if you take a razor blade and slice out all the different plates and sell them individually.
Yes.
And they can be $30,000-$40,000 today.
Mm-hmm.
And if you do that, then you get more than if you would sell the whole thing together.
Mm-hmm.
And this town, for good things, has started to rip out the plates and
right.
to sell them
yeah.
because they can get air conditioning, they can get another teacher, they
a
can
snow
get
plow.
Whatever.
Mm-hmm.
They're good things,
right.
but they're willing to destroy the book.
Mm-hmm.
And so Doug, who was a kid who was struggling, obviously, sees it almost unconsciously as an emblem of himself, and he resolves that he will get the 9 plates back that have been taken out of the book. So
mm-hmm.
he will make, if he gets it back, he makes a whole perfect book.
Wow.
And so it's a book about becoming a whole person.
Yes. I have to tell you, I didn't like him until about page 137.
He's an angry kid.
Yes, he was really angry, and he pushes you off.
Yeah.
And you're like, okay, fine, why do I want to read about you if you're going to be like that? But I hung in, and when he takes the pencil that I think Mr. Powell hands to him,
mm-hmm.
that you wrote a line and it said, it felt spectacular.
Yeah.
And I thought, all right, his door just opened.
Right.
He is now willing to be his best self, or try to be his best self. And so many of your characters, that one thing I kept watching and through all the different books is some choose to try to be their best self. Others stop trying to be their best self.
For many different reasons. I was at a talk in an Ojibwe school, and there was a kid in the back, red t-shirt, real quiet. And when I asked the kids to respond to these different exercises we'd done, all these hands go up, but not him.
Ah.
until finally he raises his hand and he speaks so quietly that I can't hear him. And I say, tell me again.
Yeah.
Kids turn to him, and as soon as they do, this kid physically places his hands in front of his face, just like that, to close off everything.
Wow.
The task of a writer for middle school kids is to help that kid move your hands away.
Oh.
That's what we're trying to do.
Wow.
And that's what Doug needs. He needs someone to help him move his hands away so he can confront a really amazing, beautiful world.
Mm.
And that's what he's learning to do in the course of this book, moving his hands away.
Mm-hmm. And you gave him Lil.
Lil, yeah. Lil is another, she is a sort of Lizzie.
Yeah.
Though she doesn't have the disadvantages that Lizzie has to deal with.
Mm-hmm.
She's a spunky kid too, who's funny, who can stick with him. You know, she gives him what for, even as, boy, that's an old expression. Huh? But she gives him a hard time as he sort of tries to push her away, but she will stick with him because she recognizes something there.
Mm-hmm.
And she becomes his first really great friend.
Yeah. I mean, at first he's a skinny thug. And,
but even that she would say that.
Yeah.
That she would give him a hard time.
That's right.
Yeah, but at first it's just this kid on the street. Why don't you go walk down the street with your eyes closed and see if you get run over? To someone who, at the end of the book, I mean, he is the one who is going to support her.
Yes. Yes. Yeah. Oh, that was just incredible. And the different characters, he's going to get a job for Lil's dad, and he's going to deliver groceries.
Yeah.
And because of that job, he's going to meet character after character after character. And it's wonderful to see them and to watch them turn toward him and turn away from him as the word goes around the town. They think his brother is a thief and a real thug.
Right.
And then at school, you have the same kind of thing going on.
Sure.
But he took this, and he took Vietnam, and he wove it all in there. And, it was so powerful.
Oh, thank you.
It was so powerful. But the use of the Audubon pictures, that was just amazing.
Yeah, that was the key to the book. It was the library that I first began this with is Flint Public Library in Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
Flint is a town which is really struggling. I mean, in a state where we're losing population, the only state in the union is Michigan.
Mm-hmm.
Flint is a town that's really, really struggling. And they do these amazing, amazing things, these programs. And they have an Audubon. Not a first, but a really, really nice Audubon.
Wow.
And the book was inspired right from that. And when I went there, saw the book on the way home.
Uh-huh.
I'm listening to NPR, and there's a story of a Wyeth that's hanging in a Pennsylvania school.
Uh-huh.
School is trying to decide, do we sell it and get $1 million and endow another teacher or two or three, or do we keep it and let generations of kids see an original N.C. Wyeth?
Yes.
And they sold it.
Wow.
And it feels very much like the same thing, because the money that they got is for good reason.
Right.
But you still lose an N.C. Wyeth original there.
Now, your books have Darwin.
Mm-hmm.
They have...
Greatest writer of the 19th century.
They have the Aeneid. Mm-hmm. They have Chaucer. And I was thinking this morning that what you write and what you write about and how you write it is like a challenge to where technology is coming into our children's lives and trying to grab their souls away. You are bringing in and showing them the other picture, the good stuff that's there, that's been there for generations. And do you feel that at all? Or because I really felt that after I finished reading all your books.
Well, Shakespeare, I mean, what his goal is, I mean, the major goal of a Shakespeare play, though we tend to elevate it out of the stratosphere.
Mm-hmm.
But what Shakespeare wants to do first, before all things, is to tell a good story.
Mm-hmm.
That's what he really, really wants to do. And so in Wednesday Wars, I wanted to demystify Shakespeare somewhat so that you do realize this is just fabulous storytelling.
Right.
Or the Aeneid, this guy who founds a city.
Yeah.
Darwin, I think, is truly, I think he's the greatest writer of the 19th century, just as a writer.
Mm.
And his ideas are revolutionary.
Mm-hmm.
Don't you pay attention to the best? All of those things I wanted to bring in. Chaucer, of course, one of the greatest storytellers. If you had just a storytelling category, Chaucer would win in English.
Yeah.
And so I do think it's important. And in when I was growing up, in my middle school years, I did read a lot of Shakespeare. I did read Chaucer.
Mm-hmm.
I did read the Aeneid, not in Latin.
Mm-hmm.
And those were really important for me. Those stories were terrific and important for me.
Mm-hmm.
There's a great series right now, the Rick Riordan series, the Lightning Thief series. What a fabulous thing. I have a kiddo who's reading those right now and just whipping through them. And I think, wow, he's learning the Greek gods here. And from that will grow other things. I just got him Edith Hamilton's mythology book. And
I mean,
just yesterday, handed this book to him.
I can't tell you how many kids come into the library looking now for books
Absolutely.
Of mythology.
Yes. Who is this guy? Who is Ares?
Yes.
Who is Poseidon? What are the stories? And we're driving home. I hand him this book, and that's it. The rest of the drive home. That's fantastic. Those are the old stories that still need to stay around.
I hope everybody gets a chance to get the whole collection of what he has here, because for the kids who can't figure out what the questions are, they feel them, but they can't put them into words. The characters in his books walk through them, and you can really get a hold of them and start asking them for yourself. I'm gonna go ahead and say that I think the man that is sitting across from me is truly a genius, and that what he has given to our children through his books can take them in such good directions and entertain them at the same time. So I cannot thank you enough
thank
for coming
you.
In today.
Thanks.
This was just such a privilege
and
a pleasure. And we're both okay for now. are you? So thanks so much for being with us. And as always, come see us at the library.